Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Javro, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenters today are John Norden, Andy Dunnigan, and Steve Kindergan with Pritchard and Jordan. John earned his BBA in risk management and insurance from the University of Georgia. He obtained chartered property and casualty underwriter and certified workers compensation professional designation. John is a licensed agent in Georgia for both property and casualty and life and employee benefits. He has been with Pritchard and Jordan over 17 years and became a partner in 2004. He was elected to the executive committee in 2012. John has developed particular expertise with complex risk management accounts with a focus in technology, real estate, hospitality, power and energy, manufacturing, and contracting industries. Andy has been an insurance in the industry since 2001, including extensive involvement with workers' compensation. He has been with P&J since 2007 and became partner in 2011. Andy's focus on workers' compensation, among other lines of coverage, motivated him to develop a staffing PEO and warehouse logistics practice group at P&J. Andy leads these practice groups where they serve over 125 clients nationally. He has developed programs specifically tailored for these industries, including captives, large deductible, guaranteed cost, and retro plans. Steve graduated from Georgia State University with a BA in management. Following graduation, Steve worked for the Georgia House of Representatives as a senior aide to the Speaker pro tempore. Before joining P&J in 2016, Steve worked in sales at Jackson Healthcare, focusing on small business partnerships and government accounts. Steve is active in the community, 2014 graduate of Leadership Georgia, member of Board of Directors of the Georgia State University Alumni Association, member Buckhead Business Association, and member Board of Directors for a Georgia Staffing Association. Pritchard and Jordan is one of the largest privately held insurance brokerage firms in the country. Uniquely positioned as the Georgia representative for Shirks Global and boasting one of the fastest growing staffing practices in the U.S., P&J designs and places complex insurance programs for over 120 staffing and PEO clients. For staffing companies, workers' compensation and expense management can have a significant impact on overall profitability. In today's May Industry Insider webinar series, our insurance experts will discuss workers' compensation programs available in the marketplace, along with risk management strategies for expense management, including available workers' comp programs, emerging risks, risk management procedures. And by the end of this session, you'll be positioned to take control of your insurance-related expenses for your staffing business. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A feature or the chat feature located on the toolbar. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to give your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. I will now turn the floor over to John, Andy, and Steve.
Well, thank you, Amanda, for the intro. We certainly appreciate everyone getting on the call today, and that was a heck of an intro. You all got our full bios. The bottom line is we are all insurance nerds. We will try to keep this webinar as interesting as you can make insurance, and we'll err on the side of brevity. So if we could take over control of the screen here and pull up our webinar deck. All right, so the topic today is taking control of rising costs of insurance specific to the staffing industry. today our agenda is going to be, we're going to first just, we got a pretty good overview of who we are. We'll give you a quick 30-second soundbite on Pritchard & Jordan. We're going to dovetail into the different program structure options that are available to staffing companies today, specific to workers' compensation. In the spirit of taking control of rising costs, we're going to then go into risk management techniques, things that all staffing employers should be thinking about to take control of workers' comp costs. And then the last thing we're going to go over is just emerging risks that we're seeing in the marketplace that are interesting and a little bit scary. So with that, real high-level overview, Pritchard & Jordan, as mentioned, is one of the larger privately held brokers in the Southeast. We're one of the top percent of U.S. brokers, consistently ranked as the best place to work, best practices agency. We are a member of Assurex Global. What does that mean? It's the largest consortium of privately held brokers in the world. So we have 110 partner firms worldwide. That gives us the buying power and the clout of Marsh, while being able to have the local private firm feel of client-valued resources. We are a full-service agency, so all three of us in the room are commercial property and casualty brokers. We do employee benefits and personal lines as well. And as Amanda mentioned, our staffing practice group is by far our fastest-growing practice over the last 5 years. We always throw this slide in. We always lead every meeting with our core values, commitment to doing things the right way with integrity, and putting our clients' best interests first in all the decisions that we make. So these are the key people that are on the call today. Myself, John Nordine, Andy Dunnigan, who runs our staffing practice, and Steve, who's one of the directors. A lot of smiling faces on this page. Everyone loves working in staffing. I'm going to turn it over to Andy now to talk about the three common program structures for workers' comp in the staffing industry.
Yeah, so enough about us. Hello to everyone on the group. The three program structures we're going to cover today are guaranteed costs, large deductible, and captives. Typically in that order, as we're working with staffing firms from startups to well-established some of the largest privately held staffing firms in the country, this is where we see their transition as they start off in a guaranteed cost insurance program, work their way to a large deductible, and then ultimately to a captive. Those are the three that we're going to dive into and give you a high-level overview of those three programs. So first is guaranteed cost, and I will define that term. That's an insurance term, guaranteed cost. That is basically a workers' compensation insurance policy with a deductible per claim of anywhere from $0 to $2,500. That's how the insurance industry defines guaranteed cost. We're going to talk about one guaranteed cost program that's the leader in the industry, and that is Key Risk. There are other guaranteed cost programs out there, but We feel Key Risk is kind of an innovator and leading the charge as we speak today. They are an A-rated carrier, which means there's a third party that comes in and evaluates their financial stability, which is very important. As you're partnering with an insurance carrier, you don't want to read the newspaper one day that they're going insolvent and you're not sure who's going to pay your claims. So it's important that we partner with financially stable insurance carriers. So what will Key Risk or these guaranteed costs consider? I think there's a fallacy in the industry that no one will consider a startup. That can be true with some guaranteed cost carriers, but with the few that we partner with, startups will be considered, but it's going to be heavily reliant on the resume of the owners and executives and showing that there's previous staffing experience. So typically, an underwriter will rely on your prior claims experience. Here, the insurance carrier is going to take a leap of faith on what your body of work has been in the past and make sure that you have experience there. In order to qualify for these guaranteed cost policies, there's typically a minimum annual premium based on payroll projections that it generates $100,000 in annual premium. That can come down slightly, but $100,000 is a good baseline. We do have a couple partners that will dip down to $50,000, and it just all depends, and we'll go through some of that. With Key Risk, they are licensed in all 50 states, and we know some states are rather problematic, New York, California. So it's important that as you grow as a staffing firm, that they can cover all the states. And in this program, they can't cover all the states. And as I go through these programs, I'm going to mention some pros and cons. The pros for guaranteed cost, it is as defined, the budget stability. You know when you're going into it based on your payroll projections what your cost is going to be. There is little to no down payment to enter into a guaranteed cost program. Some of the cons is you have very little control of the actual rates. Insurance companies file their rates based on how their book of business within a certain industry is performing. And so even if you have good performance in a certain year, but that insurance carrier has not had good performance with their book, your rates could be going up just due to their filings each year. So that can be frustrating with being in a guaranteed cost program. And then also there's little to no upside if you control your claims. Yes, you can maybe get a premium reduction at renewal, but we'll go through some of the other programs where if you control your claims costs, there could be a substantial upside from a cost standpoint. Now we're going to transition into large deductible. I'm going to talk about two large deductible programs here. The one on the left is Program 1. They are a non-rated carrier but admitted. What that means is they have not had a third party come in and establish their financial stability, but they are admitted, which is very important because that means they are regulated by the Office of Insurance. They have a limited coverage map, and you'll see the states. I'm not going to read those to you there. So it's important that, you know, looking at your growth plans, if you're going to grow in a state that your insurance company is not licensed in, those are some of the questions that you need to ask your broker when entering into a certain program. Because if, for instance, if you want to grow in New York and you know you're going to grow in New York, but your program is not licensed, this could be a very important component. The minimum annual premium to get in this program would be $50,000. That would be on the low end. These are typically closer to $75,000 to $100,000 as well. And they also offer deductibles ranging from zero to $1 million. The larger your premium is, would correlate to the larger the deductible could be. Switching over to Program 2, they are an A-plus rated carrier, licensed in all 50 states. But the one caveat to Program 1 is that they require a minimum annual premium of $250,000. And then they start at a larger deductible threshold at $100,000 minimum per claim and can go all the way up to $1 million. Some of the pros and cons to transitioning from a guaranteed cost to a large deductible is you have a lot more say and control of the claim outcome. Meaning that the adjusters are going to work hand-in-hand with your internal claims administrator, setting reserves, when to settle. And a lot of times, in a guaranteed cost, the insurance carrier is going to make that decision for you, which can be frustrating sometimes. And so this gives you more control of your claims. There's also a lot of upside for having a good claim performance year. In these programs, one thing I will mention, as an example, if you had a $100,000 deductible, your rates will be discounted in the range of 40%. But then you have to factor in what is your claim cost going to be within that deductible layer. So you have a wide margin to drive down costs because of the discounted rates, but that could turn into a con of the program should you have a bad year on the claims side. So it could be a win or lose, and we're going to go through some strategies to take this next step into a large deductible and to control that cost and do so confidently. The other downside maybe to a large deductible is the cost of entry or to start the program. There's typically a pretty substantial down payment or letter of credit that's posted. You're going to hear me mention letter of credit or collateral throughout the presentation. And so what that is the insurance carrier does not want to take on credit risk. Credit risk meaning if you have a $100,000 deductible and you're having claims within that layer, the insurance carrier is going to bill you for those claims. They want to make sure that they have some type of security on file should you move to a different program or go out of business. They don't want to be left holding the bag for those open claims should you decide to go elsewhere. So their regulators require them to have collateral and security on hand to remove them from any type of credit risk as it relates to claims.
So just to add on that real quick, the theme of this is of this webinar is taking control of rising costs. So for a lot of companies, they find themselves in growth mode. We've grown the company significantly. Our premiums have grown. In addition, we're in a guaranteed cost program. We're performing exceptionally well. Our loss ratio is great, and we want to take control of rising workers' comp costs. It's the second largest spend for our company next to payroll. The large deductible program is the natural transition for those type of companies moving from a guaranteed cost to a large deductible to take control and not be 100% beholden to insurance company rates. And that is a sunk cost. If we perform better than our premium, they keep that money. So this gives us an avenue to make it more of a profit center and take control.
That's a good point, John. Thank you. So we'll jump into captives. These are for well-established, large staffing organizations that have gone into a large deductible, that have established risk management program, that understand the ins and outs to the expenses in a large deductible, and they want to take even more control. So the definition of a captive is basically a closely held insurance company established to insure a risk. And what we're talking about today is insuring the workers' comp. There's three types of captives we're going to talk about. Really, two is a single parent and a group. I'll touch on the segregated cell, but a single parent captive is established here on domestically or offshore, and the captive owner, which would be the staffing firm, would insure a portion of their workers' compensation up to a certain layer. That certain layer is typically at $500,000, but can come down to $150,000. At that point in time, they would buy reinsurance to insure anything that goes over and above that layer. All of these programs are A-rated. They're licensed in all 50 states. The difference between a single parent and a group is exactly what it is. There's a group of people that come together and say, we want to share in the risk. We don't want to take all the risk. And then you establish the certain layers on what you want to insure and take on risk. There's two type of group captives. There's homogeneous, which is all similar industries, which would be a staffing-only group captive. And then there's heterogeneous, which is a mixture of different industries. So it could be a staffing company, it could be construction, it could be hospitality. And there's usually a board of directors set up, there's underwriting guidelines, there's a certain level of entry and an interview process in order to get into a group captive. The pros of a captive is really taking control of the expenses of the claim. And what I mean by that is the owner of the captive gets to select all of the vendors that are behind the scenes of an insurance company. And that would be your adjusters, your surveillance, your return to work program. You get to select and bid out those vendors, which every single time will drive down the expense of the claim. So when you have a claim, there's an expense portion of the claim. There's the medical bills, there's the indemnity payments to the employee, but there's an expense to manage the claim. That's really the biggest benefit of a captive is managing those expenses. So if you manage the expenses more aggressively, the claims cost will ultimately drive down. The cons to these captives is the collateral portion. It requires a substantial amount of collateral to get into. And then in the group setting, it is the risk sharing. So when even if you are controlling your losses and you have a good year, but a couple of your group members have a bad year, you could be subject to assessments up to a certain level. So that's all we're going to cover on the programs. That is a high level of the programs available in the marketplace. As John mentioned, we insure over 100 staffing firms, and these are the more popular programs that the majority of our staffing firms are entertaining that are all different makes, sizes, and models.
So transitioning real quick, in the spirit of controlling costs, regardless of which program structure we're currently in, we would argue that workers' comp, of all the policies that a company places, is the most controllable in terms of cost. Everyone is familiar with an experience modification factor that is indicative of our company's specific loss history compared to the average. If we perform better than the average, we get a credit on our premium. This slide gives a kind of a broad level overview of when selecting a broker partner to assist with driving down cost. And this is just as important as selecting your attorney, your CPA. The expectation of broker services goes beyond just purchase and placement of a policy. So if we truly want to control our costs long term, the company must drive a safety culture. It has to come from the top down. They have to embrace the safety culture. They have to be willing to invest in it. But how does our broker help support those initiatives in the way of preventative strategies? Certainly, buying insurance is a portion of what we do, but once a policy is in place, what do we do as a broker to help support those preventative strategies to improve your positioning in the marketplace to prevent claims and long-term drive down cost? Next slide, please. Sorry, bear with us 1 second. We just had a little delay in transitioning slide deck. The next slide that's going to come up at some point is the high-level overview of this process of controlling workers' comp claims. Amanda, we've got a little bit of a frozen screen here, it looks like.
There, we're back.
Okay, let me see if I can do it from my side.
Oh, we're driving now. There we go. All right, we're back. So from a high-level roadmap of how can an employer take control of workers' comp claims, we call it P4. You can call it whatever you will, but it breaks down into four big buckets of pre-hire, prior to hiring the right people, post-offer, what we're doing to have our ducks in a row if claims should arise down the road, prevention, and then post-claim. There is a reactive side to this business. If claims do happen, what do we do after the claim occurs? So in the pre-hire bucket, things from starting with the application, many employers are starting to use integrity testing, which has been a very good indicator of employees that would steal, use drugs, be a malingerer on workers' comp, and certainly weeding out the bad apples before we hire them is very important. Having written job descriptions with physical demands of what, you know, being able to clearly define what is involved in that job should a work comp claim occur. Being a drug-free workplace, which not only gives a credit on the front end, but hopefully prevents claims from occurring. Now we've made the offer, we move into post-offer drug testing, post-offer medical questionnaire that we can keep in that employee's file should a claim occur that we can then assert was due to a pre-existing condition. What are we doing in terms of new hire safety orientation? Do we have a consistent model that is conducive to our safety culture? Once employees are in-house, what are we doing from a preventative standpoint? For a lot of our employees, we're pushing out learning management systems to push training, everything from safety motivation to progressive discipline, depending on whatever their job category is. And then, as I mentioned before, post-claim, when an event does happen, having it reported timely, doing the right things in the right order to prevent that claim from spiraling.
Yeah.
Anything you'd add there?
I would say every section is just as important as the next. If you're doing a really good job on the pre-hire, but you're not doing a good job on the post-claim, it's going to be a broken risk management system. I mean, you have to have your eye on the ball in all four sections. I will comment on the pre-employment testing. I get a lot of pushback on this because we all know it's hard enough to find people to fill orders. And so having this integrity test, it will screen out probably 20% of your applicants, which, you know, for a recruiter is frightening because they're trying to fill the orders. But I will say it directly correlates to the claims, because the 20% of the employees it's screening out are the ones that are having the fraudulent claims, that are just making bad decisions. It not only tests the integrity, it also screens out high-risk behavior. So the people that are on a forklift, that are willing to take chances or make bad decisions, it's basically kind of a personality and integrity test all lumped in one.
Typically, for our clients that have moved into a large deductible, you start thinking, well, that's the most important customer to have this P4 process in place, because they're managing their claims. The mindset of a lot of people is, if I'm on a guaranteed cost basis, that's the insurance company's money. This isn't as important. We would argue against that. One, for protecting your experience mod, but two, those companies that aren't clicking in all four of these areas, we tell them, you're not ready to go to a large deductible yet.
Yeah.
And it's just, in the spirit of controlling cost, an ounce of prevention goes a long way.
Yeah, and it could change. This is not something that you can do overnight. This is a roadmap to say, I'm gonna make sure that I have all job descriptions, and then I'm gonna make sure I aggressively investigate every claim. It takes a while to implement all these things and do it well. And so that's the progression of going back to the programs. You might be in a guaranteed cost for a number of years and work your way to get ready into a large deductible and take that leap, confidently.
We're going to close with one more slide and just a few sound bites about emerging risk outside of workers' comp, things that are going on in the insurance industry that are a bit frightening, that are topics you may want to hear about, and then we'll close with taking any questions specific to workers' comp or any of these items. So these are four buckets that are constant conversations with our clients currently. Cyber liability and specifically ransomware are two of the biggest. You can't open the paper today without seeing some new scary event that occurred from a hacker. There is no coverage in the insurance world that varies more greatly carrier to carrier than cyber liability. A lot of people have the misconception, well, I bought a cyber policy, and when you really peel back, what does it cover? In most cases, not a lot. It's important to understand the difference between first-party and third-party coverage. First-party being if we have a loss of digital assets, a direct claim against us as a result of damage or alteration or corruption, theft, or misuse of our own digital assets. Third-party being if we have client data that's stored that is compromised by a hacker of our client's information. That's a third-party claim. Network security coverage. Typical buckets of coverage for cyber liability are response and notification costs, which can spiral very quickly, investigation after a breach, IT forensics, credit monitoring, defense costs, reputational risks. For a lot of firms, they have direct business interruption coverage. Many do not. But what happens if our largest client suffers a breach or our cloud provider has an issue? Contingent business interruption coverage is extremely important. In this bucket, we would highly recommend a close review of your policy, both the coverage enhancements and then what coverages have they put sublimits on, where they've really greatly restricted coverage. Many times you can build it back to full limits just by asking. From a risk management standpoint, in terms of prevention, obviously IT safeguards, encryption, in the spirit of training employees, we're recommending employee cyber awareness training. Most of the time, malware gets out in the systems because an employee clicks on a Dropbox they shouldn't. And then finally, there's a lot of carrier resources that when you buy a cyber policy, in terms of offering penetration testing and other services that you can get for free just by asking. The scariest thing we're seeing right now in that same vein is ransomware. So in 2018 thus far, ransomware is the cause of almost 40% of any malware-related data breach. That's more than double the prior year. We are seeing more and more clients that really don't even have an online presence that have an employee that clicks on something they shouldn't, that lets out ransomware, that holds their systems hostage. It's becoming very, very prevalent. There's an estimate that over the next 5 years, 80% of all businesses in the United States will be subject to a ransomware attack. It's extremely easy to deploy ransomware. For a hacker, it's very low risk, high reward, and it's easy for them to monetize via cryptocurrency. We're seeing that rather than just individual desktops get hit, more and more they are impacting business critical systems, so the ransom demands have gone through the roof. Here again, it's important to review, do you have coverage for ransomware built into your cyber policy, and does it cover cryptocurrency? Because many of them restrict to just to not covering cryptocurrency. One of the items, that third bucket we put up here just because we're seeing claims go through the roof the last couple of years, is employment practices liability. This policy covers any discrimination, harassment, wrongful termination claims against the employer. Obviously, in the hashtag MeToo environment and everything that's going on in the political, in the media, these claims have gone up quite a bit. The average discrimination case is now up over $235,000. You still read that almost 90% of employees that are harassed in the workplace do not file a complaint. We, based on the claims trends we have seen, we believe that is changing. More employees are speaking out and filing claims. 75% of harassment victims experience retaliation after they reported the claim, which retaliation is also something that falls under employment-related practices. This area can be problematic when you're a staffing company because many times your employees are working under a co-employment arrangement where they're working at a different job site and you only have so much control. So something to be vigilant about in this environment. And then the last item we put up there, and this is more, you know, certainly applies to commercial vehicles, but it affects everybody on a personal level, is the growing trend of the epidemic of distracted drivers and how that's impacting the auto industry. There is increased frequency and severity nationwide. Frequency just due to more people driving, looking at their phone, so the number of accidents have gone up. But severity, so the number of accidents where there is over 55 mile per hour impact without a single tap of the brakes has gone through the roof. The minor fender benders that used to cost $500 are now over $3,000 because you've got cameras in the bumpers. The cost to fix an accident has increased 20% in the last 3 years. Auto fatalities are up 8% in the last year, and the cost to settle fatalities 10 years ago was about $1.9 million, the average, and now it's up over $3.5 million. So you roll all that up, and the combined loss ratio for auto nationwide is over 110%, which means for every dollar the industry takes in, they pay out $1.10 in claims. It's not sustainable. The largest writer of insurance, of auto insurance in this country, is still State Farm. Their loss ratio is 117%. Unfortunately, Georgia just passed Michigan as the worst state in the country for auto loss ratios, so it's impacting us down in Atlanta more than many. But nationwide, people are seeing auto rate increases. And so here again, in the spirit of controlling your insurance costs, pushing defensive driving, cell phone usage policies is paramount right now. Sorry, we threw a lot at you. I'm going to take a breath here. This is the end of our slide deck, but in the topics of emerging risk or workers' compensation, are there any questions from the group?
Hello. As people are going ahead and entering your question, you can do it in the chat or the Q&A feature. I'm going to go ahead and open up a poll. Please feel free to give us your feedback and let us know what questions you have about some of your insurance-related expenses. As people are preparing that information, would you mind sharing some of your experiences or best practices overview of, you know, some takeaways that the staffing companies can implement right away to start controlling their costs?
Yeah, I would probably say two or three takeaways. If there's three things that you're going to work on, and I'm making the assumption that you're not doing any of these things. So what would be the three most important things to implement? Drug testing, job descriptions, and post-offer health questionnaires. Drug testing is the obvious one. If, you know, if after an injury, drug test them within 4 to 8 hours, depending on alcohol or drugs. So then you can set up a defense for the claim. A health questionnaire. So what the health questionnaire can do, after you offer a job, if you give them this one-page post-offer health questionnaire, and let's say they fill that out and they said that they have never had back surgery, they've never had any back problems. So you place them in a job where they're going to be lifting maybe, let's say, 50 pounds. Or they go out of the job and then it's day two and then they say, oh, I pulled my back. You can look at that post-offer health questionnaire. They were not truthful. You can use that as the defense for the claim. So that's very important. That's a very easy firewall. And if anyone's interested, I can send you that form that you can implement. Drug testing, health questionnaires, and job descriptions. So job descriptions is very important because when you have an injured worker and they go see that physician and the physician is trying to figure out can they go back to work and there's no job description on file, guess who's going to come up with a job description to claim it, and it's never exactly accurate. So it makes it tough for that employee to get back to work, and it makes it tough for the physician to release them back to work, which escalates the cost of the claim. So those are, I think, the three top takeaways on the risk management prevention side.
Wonderful. Thank you. In your P4 scenario, the claims management, do you have any techniques or suggestions for best practices in claims management post-accident, how to get people back to work?
That's a good question. So the back to work is an issue within the staffing industry because if when the injured worker is hurt and say they're going to be out for more than a week, that's what we consider, you know, lost time, and your client wants a new able-bodied employee. So you want to try to get them back to work to get them off their feet and then to mitigate the cost of the claim. And the staffing firm might not have a location nearby where they can bring them in corporately to do a small job or task. I would probably say 80% of our staffing organizations partner with a third-party return-to-work company. And what that return-to-work company does, if there's an injured worker and they're going to be out for more than a week, we refer them over to the third-party return-to-work company. That third-party company then places them in a local nonprofit close to their house. And they're not going to be operating machinery, vehicles, counting money, dealing with money. They could be a greeter at a Goodwill or almost kind of like a volunteer position, but they will be paying at least minimum wage. That's been very successful in getting people back to work and having a solution every single time, no matter the case.
And
on all of these,
go ahead. If they decline those type of positions, does that put you in a better position for the claim?
Absolutely. So if you make them a valid job offer and they do not show and or they decline, then you can cease indemnity benefits. You still have to pay medical. So any indemnity, which is basically what you're paying them depending on the state, a percentage of their wages. So it's very, very important to have a return to work program to cut down the cost of the indemnity claim. That's a very good question. Thank you for bringing that up.
You had mentioned there's a couple of states that are far more difficult to get into for workers' compensation programs, such as California, and you mentioned New York as well. Do you have any information that you can share with the staffing companies on the phone today as to what things they can do to help themselves in some of those tougher markets?
I would say do not go into California until you fully understand California. There's what they call CT claims, cumulative trauma. So you could be tied to a claim that happens 2 years after their employment, and you get tied to a portion of the claim. It's just California law. The cost of the claims is substantially higher than, let's just say, Georgia. I would probably say 3 or 4 times higher. They're tougher to settle, and you get tied back to them. And you will see the workers' compensation rates reflect that. If you are in the warehousing industry, your workers' compensation rate in Georgia might be $6 versus $18 to $20 in California. So just be very careful. You can make money in California, and I know many of you do. You can just never know what the tail of a workers' compensation claim is going to cost, and it could pop up a year or two after maybe you cease a contract with a client. Where a claimant pops up and all of a sudden you get tied to one of what I was describing as a CT claim. New York is tough just with the political landscape. They're very liberal, and it just makes it a tough environment for workers' comp. It's not as tough as California. And so with all that being said, there's a lot of insurance companies choosing not to do business there because it's been unprofitable for them.
And your firm is able to provide staffing clients with workers' comp carriers in all 50 states, regardless of the particular environment in that state, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And to be honest, the reason the insurance carriers maybe the insurance carrier will publish that they do not do business in New York and California, but if we present the right opportunity to the insurance company and say we're controlling costs with our P4 method, with all the other strategies that we're implementing, they say we'll take a shot at it in New York and California because we got a better than average chance to make money. And we're going to roll that out with all the other states. So absolutely we could entertain New York and California. We want to just make sure it's the right situation for the staffing client and the insurance carrier, that it's going to be a long-term profitable play for all parties. We're mainly just advising and looking at it. We can absolutely do it. We just want to take a close eye.
Wonderful. Okay. Well, I don't see any other questions that have come in, but I will go ahead and put our contact information up on the next screen here. If you have any questions that you'd like to take offline and look at on a one-on-one basis specific to your staffing firm's needs, please feel free to reach out to Andy, John, or Steve directly. Again, their email and phone number is listed here for you. If you have any other questions, you know, please feel free to reach out to them directly. We'll also have a recording of today's webinar available on our website for anyone who may have missed it, or if you want to share that with others in your industry. Again, thank you so much for your time today, and I think we'll wrap things up here unless Andy, John, or Steve, you had any final comments for the group?
Appreciate the opportunity. Hope everyone got something out of it.
Wonderful. Thank you guys very much. I hope you have a wonderful day, and thanks for joining the webinar today.